Hello everyone, welcome back to AeroHub and welcome to the series of lectures in aerospace structures. In the previous lecture we discussed about the design procedure of a eccentrically loaded riveted joint, and in this lecture through a numerical problem we will try to understand the sizing procedure of an eccentrically loaded riveted joint. And you have this question here. You can see in the diagram we have certain rivets here. We have 6 rivets. We can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. And a load of 50 kN is acting at a distance of 40 cm from the center of gravity of the rivet system. And it is given in the question. The rivet system is made up of steel bracket and the bracket plate is 2.5 cm thick. And all the rivets are having the same size, so we have to assume the area is same. And load on the bracket is 50 N, the rivet spacing is 10 cm. You can see the rivet spacing is 10 cm from the center of gravity. That is, for rivet 1 to the center of gravity, it is 10 cm in both in X and Y direction. And the load arm, that is nothing but the X intensity, is 40 cm. The permissible shear stress is 65 MPa and the crushing stress is 120 MPa. They are asking to find out the size of the rivet. Okay. They are asking to find out the size of the rivet, mean we have to estimate the diameter of the rivet. Okay. The required diameter of the rivet. And to find out the diameter or to size the rivet for this eccentric loaded riveted joint, we need to find out the primary shear and secondary shear for load acting on the rivet. Then we will find out the resultant shear load, and we will find out the critical rivet. Critical rivet is the rivet at which is subjected to the maximum resultant shear load. Okay, so in this case we have 6 rivets here. You can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. And among these 6 rivets, yes, one rivet will be subjected to more amount of shear load when compared to other rivet. And from that rivet, we have to find out the diameter. That is, they have given the value of shear stress. Shear stress is given tau is equal to 65 MPa. Okay, so shear stress is nothing but shear force. That is, I can write a resultant shear force into the area. That is, area is pi by 4 d square. Okay, what we require is the diameter. Okay, so the diameter will be, so I can write tau okay, so from this equation I can write d square is equal to 4 tau divided by pi into r, and d will be equal to root of 4 tau divided by pi r. Okay, where tau is given as 65 MPa and r is the resultant shear load acting on the critical rivet. We will always take the critical rivet to estimate the value of diameter of the rivet. Okay, so first of all we will find out the value of primary shear stress. The primary shear stress is given by P dash is equal to the applied load divided by N. N is nothing but the number of rivet. So we have 6 rivet in the rivet system. So the applied load is 50 kN. So it will be 50 into 10 power 3 divided by 6. So I will be getting an answer of 8333 N. This is the value of primary shear load. Okay, so we basically have 6 rivet, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and this is our rivet system. Okay, and this is our first rivet, this is second one, this is third, this is fourth, and this one is the fifth one, and this one is the rivet number 6. Okay, so I am applying a load of 50 kilonewton at a distance 40. Okay, so this is the center of gravity. I will assume somewhere here as the center of gravity G. Okay, we are applying load downwards, therefore the primary shear load I will take as reaction. Okay, so it will be acting upwards. So this will be P1 dash and this will be P2 dash, this will be P3 dash, this will be P4 dash and this will be P5 dash and this is P6 dash. Okay, now we have to find out the value of secondary shear load. So P double dash is secondary shear load and this secondary shear load is proportional to the radial distance connecting the center of the rivet to the centroid of the rivet system. Okay, so this is the radial distance for rivet number 1 L1, this is the radial distance for rivet number 2 L2 and this is the radial distance L3 and this is the radial distance L6 and this is the radial distance L4 and this one is L5. Okay, and in the question they have given the dimensions here. This is 10 centimeter and this dimension also is 10. Basically the value of x bar comma y bar is 10, 10 in centimeter. Okay, so this distance is 10 and this distance is 10. Okay, so L1 is equal to L2 is equal to L4 is equal to L5. That will be equal to root of, this is 10 and this value is also 10. So it will be 10 square plus 10 square. So I will be getting root of 200. That will be 14.14 centimeter. I will convert into meter. It will be 0.01414 meter. Okay, this is the value of L1, L2, L4 and L5. What about L3 and L5, L6? L3 is equal to L6 will be equal to 10 centimeter. Okay, and now we have to find out the, we have to estimate the direction of secondary shear load. And you are aware that the secondary shear load will be perpendicular to the line joining the center of the rivet and the centroid of the rivet system. Okay, and I applied a load in the downward direction. This produces a clockwise moment. So I'll be taking reaction moment. Since we have taken reaction for primary shear load, I will be taking reaction for the secondary shear load. So this will be producing counterclockwise moment. Okay, so it will be counterclockwise, adding in this direction. Therefore, this will be P1 double dash because it is acting in the counterclockwise direction. Okay, and you can see for rivet number 6, this is the L6, that is nothing, this is the radial distance L6 and should be perpendicular, so it will be P2 double dash. Okay, and for rivet number 5, this is L5, should be perpendicular, so this is P5 double dash. And rivet number 4, this is the radial distance L4 and the perpendicular distance is this one, this will be perpendicular, so it will be P4 double dash. And rivet number 3, Yes, I understand. Rivet number three, it should be in this direction, anti-clockwise. You can see for P1, P6, P1 double dash, P2 double dash, P5 double dash, and P4 double dash is acting in the anti-clockwise direction. So for P3 double dash also should be in anti-clockwise direction. Therefore, for rivet number three, the direction of primary shear load and secondary shear load are the same. Okay. And for rivet number 2, it will be in anti-clockwise, so it will be perpendicular to L2. This is the distance L2. This is the direction of P2 double dash. Okay. So you got the idea. Now, we have to think about the angle between primary shear load and secondary shear load. For this one, the angle between primary shear load and secondary shear load is θ1, and this will be θ2, and this will be same angle, that is 0 degree. This will be θ4, and this will be θ5, and this will be θ6. Okay, now we have the equation. Resultant shear load of an resultant shear load will be equal to root of P dash square plus P double dash square plus 2 times P double dash cos theta. Okay, what is critical rivet? In critical rivet, the value of resultant load will be maximum. Okay, so the value for critical rivet, the value of resultant load is maximum. The resultant load is maximum when you can see cos theta should be equal to 1. Okay, when resultant load is maximum, when cos theta should be equal to 1, that means the value of theta should be equal to 0 for maximum value for resultant shear load. Okay, that means you have to understand that when the value of theta is small, the value of R will be high. Okay, you can see here we have 6 rivet. Okay, we don't want to find out the resultant shear load for rivet number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. We need to find out the resultant shear load for the critical rivet. From the value of resultant shear load of the critical rivet, we can find out the size of the rivet. Okay. And in this problem, in this numerical problem, we can see that for rivet number 3, the angle between primary shear load and secondary shear load is 0 degree. They are acting in the same direction. In rivet number 6, they are acting in reverse direction. That is, the angle between primary shear load and secondary shear load in rivet number 6 will be equal to 180 degree. Okay. So, we have to find out the We know the value of primary shear load for rivet number 3, that is 833 Newton. That is same for this same for all rivet. Okay. Now we have to find out the secondary shear load for rivet number 3. Okay. So we have the formula. I will write here. P3 double dash. We derived this formula in last lecture. That will be P into E into L3 divided by L1 square plus L2 square plus L3 square plus L4 square plus up to L6 square. This is the formula. I think I derived this equation in the previous lecture. Okay, now we'll find out the value of P3 double dash. We have to find out the secondary shear load acting on rivet number 3. This is the formula. P3 double dash is equal to PE, where P is the eccentric load, E is the eccentricity or distance between the load and the centroid of the center of gravity of the rivet system. L3 is the radial distance of rivet number 3. L1 square plus L2 square plus L3 square plus L4 square up to L6 square. And we know that L1, L2, L5 and L4 having the same radial distance, that is a 14.14 centimeter. We found out that. And L3 and L6 is equal to 10 centimeter. So substituting the value, the value of P is 50 into 10 power 3 into the value of E is 0.40 centimeter. The value of E is 40 centimeter and L3 is 10 centimeter. I will convert into meter. That will be 0.4 into 0.1. And you are aware that we have L1, L2, L5 and L4 is same value, so it will be 4 into 0.1414 the whole square, plus we have L3 and L6 having same dimension, so it will be 2 times into 0.1 square. So I will be getting the value of P3 double dash, so I will be getting 20,000. Okay, this is the value of P3 double dash. You have to calculate that, and the resultant, you are aware, resultant load is equal to P3 dash plus P3 double dash square plus 2P3 dash 2P3 double dash cos theta. Okay, and theta here it is 0, so finally it will become P3 dash square plus P3 double dash square plus 2P3 dash plus 2P3 double dash. That is A plus B the whole square. So will be R will be equal to root of P3 dash square plus P3 double dash square plus 2P3 dash P3. This is not 2P3, 2P3. Double dash, that is B, A plus B the whole square. So I can write R is equal to root of P3 dash plus P3 double dash the whole square. So R will be equal to P3 dash plus P3 double dash. Okay, this formula is valid when theta is equal to 0 degree. So resultant load I have P3 dash, that is nothing but the primary shear load, at least. How much? Primary shear load. So primary shear load is 8,333 Newton plus 20,000. Okay, so I will be getting 28,333 Newton. Okay. Is it correct? Yes, 28,003. This is the value of primary resultant load acting on the rivet. Okay, now we have the formula tau is equal to resultant load divided by the area, that is pi by 4 d square. From this I can get the value of d will be equal to root of 4r divided by pi into tau. So you can find out the answer. When you substitute the value of R as 28,333 Newton and the value of pi and the value of tau, tau is nothing but 65 megapascal, then 65 into 10 power 6 Newton per meter square. So finally you will be getting the answer of 0.0235 meter. Okay, that is equal to 23.5 millimeter, and this is the value of diameter of the rivet that is required to required for this loading condition. So this is about this lecture, and in the next lecture we will see about tension field beam, and that will be the end of the aerospace structures. Thank you for listening. Take care.